Good morning. If we could make our way to our seats, that'd be great. Well, guys, we're back in the room, which is brilliant. And for those online, you can see we're all Christmassy. It's beginning to feel a lot like Christmas. Should I sing? No, we won't. We won't. Sore throat. Won't. Okay. So, first of all, let me just wish you a Merry Christmas. Because we're in that season, and it is the season to be jolly. Just as Boris says, not too jolly. But be jolly. Okay. So, today, Pete Wash is going to be bringing us the word. We're going to be continuing our series on the book of Acts. I hope you're all enjoying it. I hope you're all getting into it. I hope you're all understanding it, and I hope that God is speaking to you through it. So, one of the things that God kind of spoke to me about in this book of Acts is this. Don't worry, you're not getting a sermon from me. You'll be okay. It's very simple. Somebody say really then. Okay, Acts 2. And it's a very simple thing. But it's something I think is quite important to us. Acts 2:49. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Now, in those few things, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Hence why we're doing this teaching on the book of Acts. We're going through the word. They devoted themselves to each other, to the fellowship, to coming together. And guys, I just want to thank you. We are helping people outside of this church with the donations that you guys have given. And I want to just say thank you for that. So there'll be a family that has a Christmas this year when they wouldn't have had before. So I just want to bless you for that and say thank you. And I want to thank you for your devotion to each other, the phone calls that people are doing, getting in touch with those that aren't quite with us yet, that are still isolating, those that have had to isolate even this week because of taxi drivers that had COVID. So keep them in your prayers, keep lifting them up. The other thing that it says is that they devoted themselves to prayer, and the prayer meetings have in a way continued all the way throughout lockdown. We've had people in the room praying, and it's been good. It's been a good sense of God's peace and God's presence in this place. There have been words of kind of prophetic words and pictures given that I'll be sending out to everybody so you can see them and chew on them and just see what God's saying to you. We are starting our prayer meetings back up on Tuesday. Those are the prayer meetings that will be led prayer meetings where we will come together corporately to pray. Instead of what we've had to do, which has been individual prayer. It's been great to just have the time to spend in God's presence. But it'll be great to come together to corporately pray about the things that God is putting on our hearts. So, we're devoting ourselves to each other. We're devoting ourselves to the teachings of the apostles. We're devoting ourselves to prayer. And it also says they devoted themselves to the breaking of bread. So this morning, I felt quite challenged to give us an opportunity to break bread together. Now you will see, and for those that are online, if you want to press pause right now and run and go and get yourself some wine and a biscuit or some bread, that would be great. And then you can join in with us. But obviously with COVID, things are a little bit different. So I want to show you what we've done. We've got hold of some of these pre-packed, sealed units. All COVID secure, all clean. Nobody's messed with it. You rip off the first layer and I'll do it for you. There you go. And you get a little unleavened bread wafer. So what we're going to do is we're going to take these cups back to our seats and we're going to do this together. We'll break that and then we'll take the bread. Then there's another little, I won't open that one because that'll go everywhere. Then there's another one that you peel back, and there's the wine. And we'll take that together as well. Now, we are going to have to do this a little bit differently. So what I'm going to ask is that anybody that wants to partake, there's no pressure on you. It's totally up to you if you feel comfortable doing this. But if you want to partake of this, then I want to ask that one person from the bubble, and I'll kind of point in an area, one person from that bubble comes and collects enough cups for everybody in that bubble. And then we'll do communion together. Okay? So I'm going to put some music on, and then I'm going to start pointing at people, and we're going to do communion first and just start off by breaking bread together. 3, 2, 1. If you guys would like to. Just shake your head at me if you want this to be passed over. Carol? On that night, Jesus took the bread. And he broke it. And he said, "This is my body given for you, broken for you. Whenever you eat this bread, remember me." Thank you, Jesus. In the same way, he took the cup and he said, "This is my blood. This is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you, spilt for you." He said, "Whenever you drink this, remember me." Thank you, Jesus. Father God, we thank you this morning that in all of this we can come before you and we can break bread together and we can drink the wine together and we can remember you, Lord Jesus. Your sacrifice on that cross for us, willingly given to pay the ransom for us, to wash us clean of our sin. Lord, however alien that felt just then, Lord, we thank you for the truth behind it, that your body was broken for us, that your blood was spilt for us. Let us always remember you, Lord, and let us proclaim that you never stayed in the grave, but that you are at the right hand of the Father right now, Lord Jesus, and you will return for your bride. Amen. Amen. Okay, so the book of Acts tells us that they were devoted to each other. They were devoted to the teachings of the apostles. They were devoted to prayer. And they were devoted to the breaking of bread. We have several things going on during the week. And I want to encourage you, these are the notices, by the way. I want to encourage you that the Zoom Life group is on a Thursday. And it would be great for you guys to get there if you can. To see each other over a screen. Yes, it's not as good as being in a room with each other. But you can cough as much as you want on your screen. And nobody stares at you. It's brilliant. You don't clear a supermarket on a screen when you cough. It's brilliant. So, Zoom, Life Group, 7:15 Thursday night. If you need the login details, please email me and I'll send them to you. We also have our prayer meeting. I said earlier, we have our prayer meeting starting back up on Tuesday night, 7:30. And that will be a led corporate prayer again. We'll be back to that. I'd encourage you to get there if you can. We have tonight at 8 o'clock, for anybody online, I may have given out the wrong time at the last life group. It's not 6 o'clock. It's 8 o'clock tonight. We have Carols with Compassion. You will see the details have been sent out on email. The details are on the Facebook page. And if you go to the website and click on Google and look for Carols with Compassion, you'll find all the details there. So that's 8 o'clock tonight. And that should be a good event. Some really good artists there doing some really great hymns. So I'd encourage you to get there if you can. Okay, we're going to move into a short time of worship. So let's just prep our hearts, prep our minds. Lord, we just want to pray for those that aren't with us right now. For Jean and Malcolm, for Clouder, for Dot, for Tony. Lord, for Mick and Joy. Lord, we just want to lift up everybody that hasn't been able to get back into the building yet, Lord. We want to just pray that your presence would be with them right now. That they would know your hand upon them. Lord, where they need healing, we pray that your touch would cast out all illness, Lord. Would remove all infirmity, Father. And would bring strength and health back to their bodies. Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Father, that you are building your family here. And we pray, Father, strengthen that. Lord, be with each one, every one of the members of the flame, of this family, of this building of living bricks that you're putting together, Lord. And let us have an encounter with you, Holy Spirit. In the room and out the room, Father. Amen. Amen. If you'd like to take your seats. Okay, children, you've been very patient. If those that are going to do today's children's work and go. And go stand by the doors. Prepare for the chaos to be unleashed. Okay, what I will do is I'll call you out again by families. You know the drill by now, children. You go do your fingers and then go sit down. Okay, Faith and Anaya. Danielle, would you like to go? Okay, we'll go with Sam. He's getting himself all sorted. He's nearly ready. And he's... Come on, Sam. Wow. He wanted to show me. Go and have fun, Sam. Okay, let's go for Ellie and the clan. Go. You're going to watch a cartoon today about an angel that can't sing. Go on then, Evie. Oh, you've got Lexi's hand. That's great. No. Okay. So let's welcome Pete Wass up. Give him a good round of applause.
Good morning, and if you have your Bible, would you turn with me to Acts chapter 20 and verse 24. So this morning we're going to be looking at a section of the book of Acts, chapters 13 to 20, and that contains one of my favourite stories in the Bible, and that's the story about the young man called Eutychus. You might remember that's the story of the young man who's at Troas. I'm looking at Dan as I'm saying this. That's the story, if you remember, that Paul was speaking to the church in Troas, and they were in a third floor room, and it says that Paul went on and on so that Eutychus fell asleep, fell out of the window and killed himself. Now, fortunately, this is a ground floor building, so that can't happen this morning. And we'll make sure, hopefully, that we contain this to less than an hour. Acts chapter 20, verse 24. Paul said this, "I consider my life worth nothing to me if only I may finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the gospel of God's grace." Let me just read you that again. Remember, this is the Apostle Paul speaking. "I consider my life worth nothing to me if only I may finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given to me." And so this morning we're going to be looking at that task, the missions that Paul went on. You'll remember that we've looked before at Paul's conversion in Acts chapter 9. And in that we read the commission that Paul was given. This is what the Lord said. "This man," talking about Paul, "is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings and before the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer in my name." Paul was given a mission by God to go and carry the gospel to the Gentiles and their kings. This morning, the section we're going to be looking at, Acts chapter 13 to 20, covers a period, we think, of approximately 10 to 12 years, roughly AD 45 to AD 57. We're going to be looking at Paul's journeys, which we think were around 10,000 miles. Now, you might have in the back of your Bible, you might have some maps which show you the journeys that Paul went on. There are four missionary journeys. This morning we're going to look at the first three. But if you haven't seen the maps, just try and picture in your mind for me, if you would, the Mediterranean. So here is Egypt. And then as you move up around above Egypt, you'll see you've got Israel. Above Israel, you've got Syria. This is in the modern day geography. And as you start to move round, you'll see that you have Turkey. And we've learned a lot, haven't we, in the last few years about the migrant crisis of people moving from Syria into Turkey, because once you're into Turkey, you've got the gateway into Europe, because next to Turkey you have, on the map around here, you've got Greece. And then just next to Greece, eventually around the Mediterranean, you'll find that you've got Italy. And those are all key countries in the story of Paul's missions. If you remember, just off the coast of Israel, you've got Cyprus. And it's probably the case that many of us have been there on holiday. And actually, we've probably therefore followed in the footsteps of Paul. But before we get into his journey, I just wanted to remind us of this. I wonder what's the longest journey you've ever been on. I did mention a few weeks ago, actually, one of the longest journeys I've ever been on is that one year I decided that I'd take the family on holiday to southern Spain. And then I'd drive there, and I talked to you about the fact of how we had to drive over the Pyrenees, over the highest bridge in the world. And that took us 3 days. What we're looking at today is a journey or journeys that Paul took that took 10 to 12 years. But they're journeys where he didn't know what the destination was. He didn't actually know where he was going. He didn't know when it was going to end. When we go on a journey now, if we jump in the car and we go down on the motorway, we know that if we go down on the M5 going down south, we know that when we get to Gloucester, we can go to the nice Gloucester services, can't we? If we go a bit further, you'll get to Michael Wood, then Gordano, all the services that you'll know. When the wife says we need to stop for a wee or something, you'll know there's a services coming up. But you know, when we look at Paul, we must remind ourselves it was nothing like that. There were no services, there were no holiday inns, there were no Premier Inns where you could stop. There was no Harvester where you could pop in for your lunch. Travel was a dangerous thing. Paul actually told the Corinthians this. He said, I have been constantly on the move. I've been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my own countrymen, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false brothers. In Paul's time, travel actually was a very difficult and dangerous thing. You'll have been reading, when you've been looking at Acts, the journeys that Paul took by sea. Again, that wasn't like going in one of the boats that we have today. I understand from what I've been reading that there are many known wrecks on the floor of the Mediterranean of ships from biblical times that easily sank. One of the things that we'll be looking at is we'll be looking at Corinth. Now, remember we spoke about Greece. If you look at a map of Greece, Greece looks a little bit like a balloon. You've got a bulb, which is what we call the Peloponnese. There's then a very small strip of land called an isthmus that then connects to the mainland of Greece. If ships sailed round that balloon, it's about 200 miles. That was a very, very dangerous area for a ship to go round, such that sailors would in fact try not to sail round it. In fact, that isthmus, that small strip of land, was 3 miles wide. And it was so dangerous to try and sail round it that what would actually often happen with ships was that they would take the ship out of the water at the harbour, and they would then move the ship across the land from one coast to another on rollers to avoid actually having to sail. So as you've been reading the book of Acts, remember, we're not talking about journeys like we face today. They were perilous times. The first journey that we read about in Acts is in Acts chapter 13 to chapter 15. And this covers the period, we think, around about AD 45 to 47. And that means that Paul has probably been a Christian for around about 10 years. Again, we mentioned earlier, remember his conversion? Remember how the Lord appeared to him in the vision, how he was blinded? 10 years since that. 10 years where Paul was sitting in the church. We know that Paul was a Pharisee, was trained in the law. 10 years in which he'd been developing his theology as the Holy Spirit taught him. One of the places that Paul went to was Pisidian Antioch. Now, you'll have heard, we were talking last week, Peter was talking about Antioch. You need to know that in the Bible there are, or in the geography of that day, there were 17 Antiochs. It can be a bit confusing when you're talking about Antioch. Pisidian Antioch is actually quite a distance. It's several thousand miles from the Antioch that Paul started his journey on. Pisidian Antioch was in Turkey. It's now ruins. We think that Paul ended up in Pisidian Antioch because, you remember from the story, he went to Cyprus, first of all, with Barnabas. And he preached there. And in the story we read that a Roman proconsul called Sergius Paulus was converted. Archaeologists have found in the ruined city of Pisidian Antioch a very large property that the inscriptions on the building show us it was owned by Sergius Paulus. So the Bible always gives us truth, doesn't it? Archaeology confirms it. Sergio Paulus was a man who existed, and it's probably likely that's why Paul and Barnabas went there. Now, the pattern that Paul developed was when he went to a town, he would very often, first of all, go to the synagogue on a Sabbath. We can read in chapter 13, verse 14, it says, on the Sabbath, they entered the synagogue and sat down. And what Paul would do, he would wait for an opportunity to be able to speak. And we read in Acts chapter 13 that that happened. Verse 39 says, it talks about about Paul standing up when he was invited to by the person that was leading the service in the synagogue that day. Paul was invited to bring a message, and he said this: through Jesus, the forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. This is Paul standing up talking to the Jews in the synagogue. Through him, everyone who believes is justified from everything you could not be justified from by the law of Moses. And we read in the story about how the Jews eventually became jealous and abusive towards Paul. And we know, don't we, from what we read earlier, that Paul was given the commission to be the light to the Gentiles. Now, in the synagogues in those days, synagogues weren't just populated by Jews. Synagogues have an area in them where Gentiles can sit. So the idea was, if you were a Gentile who was seeking, who wanted to know something about the Lord that the Jews worshipped, you might go to the synagogue, and eventually you might become converted. So on that day when Paul was speaking and proclaiming who Jesus was, eventually the Jews became angry and abusive, and the Bible tells us this: when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and honored the word of the Lord, and all who were appointed for eternal life believed. Gentiles were in the synagogue. Paul had been sent to bring the message to the Gentiles, and those who were appointed for eternal life believed. That's a fantastic verse, isn't it? Because it tells us those who were appointed for eternal life believed. You and I, in one sense, are here today because when Paul went on his journey And when he went to Pisidian Antioch, and he stood up and he proclaimed the message to the Gentiles, they believed. And because of that, the church grew. And eventually, in church history, the gospel came to our country. We owe, in a way, our faith, our knowledge, our understanding to Paul having the courage to stand up in the synagogue. The second journey that you can read about in the book of Acts is between chapters 15 and 18. One of the key events that we can see there is when Paul went to Corinth. You remember I mentioned about that balloon and the neck of a balloon and that isthmus of land? That was a really important area because of that, of the way the ships either went overland or came into the port. Corinth had the temple of Aphrodite, and it's believed that the temple of Aphrodite had 1,000 prostitutes. So people actually would come from all around to Corinth to go to the temple, perhaps for the wrong reasons and wanting something other than to worship the goddess Aphrodite. So Corinth was important for that pagan religious reason. But it was also very important because of the trade that went on there, because of the way the ships would either sail round or the way they went overland there. So it was a key place for Paul to be sent to by the Holy Spirit. And in chapter 18, we read that Paul stayed there a year and a half teaching the word of God. So Paul stayed in a city full of pagans, of what would horrify us today, somewhere that you and I would have probably driven in the car and said, we're not stopping here, going straight out. Paul stayed there a year and a half preaching the gospel to a city of pagans. And of course, you'll know if you read the story that there were believers who were there. Paul did the same thing. He preached to the Jews. And in chapter 18, we read this. When the Jews opposed Paul and became abusive, he shook out his clothes in protest and said to them, your blood be on your own heads. I am clear of my responsibility. From now on, I will go to the Gentiles. Corinth. We'll mention Corinth again because we know about Corinth, don't we? We know about the letters that Paul wrote to the Corinthian church. The third journey we read about in Acts chapter 19 to 21. And one of the events that we want to mention there is what happened to Paul in Ephesus. And again, we know about Ephesus, don't we? Because we know about Paul's letter to the Ephesians. Ephesus was in Greece. Corinth is in there as well. It was a really famous city because of the temple of Artemis. That was one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. Archaeologists tell us that that temple was 115 meters long, 46 meters wide, and the columns at the front of it alone were 13 meters high. 115 meters long. You know the story that you can read about there, how it's believed that a statue of the goddess Artemis fell from heaven, and that's why the temple was built there. We can also read that in Ephesus, you remember that riot that took place in the theatre? Do you remember that, where they chanted, great is Artemis, the goddess of the Ephesians, for 2 hours? That theatre, we know from archaeologists, held 25,000 people. So Paul was sent by the Holy Spirit to another pagan city that was full of unbelievers. And we can read in those chapters, it says that Paul spoke in the synagogue and spoke boldly. And it says that Paul actually stayed preaching for 2 years in the lecture hall of Tyrannus, which we can see to this day. And it says that God did extraordinary miracles through Paul. But it ended in a riot where Paul was nearly killed. Because every city Paul went to, society was shaken up. And I'm sure when you've been reading through Acts, you started to see a pattern that emerges for Paul. He's sent somewhere, he preaches, there's opposition, and then there's persecution. We can read about the persecution that Paul suffers. Right at the start in his first journey, we read about when he's in Lystra. And you can read there about how the Jews were so enraged by what he was saying that they stoned Paul and they threw him outside the city because they thought they'd killed him. Stoning's a terrible thing, isn't it? And you know, it still goes on, unfortunately, today in some places. But when the Jews stoned somebody, they knew what they were doing. They were doing it to kill somebody. So they thought Paul was dead. Yet we read in Acts that when he was outside the city and the believers came around him, he stood up and he went back into the city. So something happened to Paul there. Some people think Paul may in fact have been raised from the dead. Doesn't say he was, but if the Jews stoned him, what an extraordinary thing for him just to be able to get up with no broken bones and walk back into the city. We mentioned Corinth. Paul said this to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians, the second letter to the church there. He says this, "I must go on boasting, although there is nothing to be gained. I will go on to visions and revelations from the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether it was in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I don't know, but God knows, was caught up to paradise. He heard inexpressible things, things that man is not permitted to tell." Some people think that Paul is talking about himself, that when he was stoned, he was actually taken up to heaven by God. He had a vision of heaven, and that actually, at the start of his first missionary journey, transformed him. That he was given an understanding of what he got to do on these journeys, that he was in fact going to give his life. And you know from the story that it didn't end there for Paul. You can read about how Paul and Silas were flogged. They had a severe flogging. My dad went to an orphanage when he grew up. My dad tells me often that he wasn't a particularly good pupil and he regularly had the cane. And he talks to me about how it really hurt. But the Bible isn't talking about Paul having a little bit of a slap by a cane. He was severely flogged. And we know that severe flogging in itself could lead to death. Paul then was in prison. Paul paid a tremendous cost on his journeys. But the Lord was teaching him and speaking to him throughout. Some of those names of those places we mentioned, they mean something to us because we understand that Paul wrote letters to them. So one of the places he went to was Galatia. We know about the letter to the Galatians. Let me just read you one of the things that he wrote to the Galatian church. "So I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature." Paul, the man who went on this incredible journey, who suffered all these hardships, said, "Live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control." We know that the book to the Galatians was written while Paul was on his missionary journeys. And the Lord was showing him that. I think I'd have written a letter and I'd said, you know what? I really can't stand the Jews for what they've done to me. He doesn't do that. He talks about the love, the fruit of the Spirit. What about what God showed him and what he wrote to the Corinthian church? If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love. That was his motivator, wasn't it? I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but have not love, I'm nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. Do you understand why he said that? Because he knew what it was like to give everything, to give his whole body, his life. But he said, love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It is not rude, it is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see with a poor reflection as in a mirror, then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. Now these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. Paul wrote that to the Corinthian church. He knew Corinth because he'd been there. He knew the place it was. Corinth was portrayed in Greek literature as a place that was full of drunkards. But he knew what it was like, and he knew the message that he was giving, that God loved the Corinthians. Now, the book of Acts is a story, isn't it? It's history. It's a narrative. It's not in the Bible a book of doctrine. It's not something where we actually create our beliefs like we do from the Gospels or the Epistles. So what are the lessons that we learn? And I hope you've picked these up as you've been reading the book of Acts. And the first thing that struck me is the need for us to understand our culture. One of my favourite passages in Acts is when we read the speech that Paul gave in Athens. You remember, he was horrified as he walked around the city of Athens and he saw all the monuments to the different gods, even the one to the unknown God. But he said this in his speech. From one man, that's God, he made every nation of men that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he determined the time set for them and the exact places where they should live. Paul knew he was where God wanted him to be because God had ordained it. And God knows where we're meant to be, doesn't he? And he knows that we're meant to be here. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him. Though he's not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. As some of your own poets have said, those two phrases that Paul spoke there, for in him we live and move and have our being, and we are his offspring, those are both quotes that Paul was bringing from Greek philosophers. And he could do it from memory because he'd learned and understood the culture. I say that because Paul realized when he was bringing the gospel, he needed to know the people he was bringing it to. And there's a lesson there, isn't there? Because There's a sense when we become members of the body of Christ that we enter a different culture. And there can be a danger then that we actually lose or fail to understand the culture in which we live. Paul, though, knew that he needed to understand that culture if he was going to be able to preach and speak to them effectively. The next lesson we learn is that the Holy Spirit leads and guides. I mentioned that Paul didn't know where he was going. He spent 10 years on the road, but he wasn't wandering around aimlessly. He went where he was led. And you'll have read in the chapters when you've been studying it that sometimes he was prevented by the Holy Spirit from going where he thought he ought to go. Because the Holy Spirit leads and guides if we let him and if we allow him to do that. Paul did. There's a lesson there for us. In the letter to the Galatian church, Paul said this: "Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up." Let me read you that again. This is Paul writing. "Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up." One of the lessons that we read about in the book of Acts is perseverance. I think Dave mentioned at the house group on Thursday that some of the churches that Paul went to, we have this idea that they must have been huge. They weren't. There might have been a handful of people at the start. Paul persevered. He went, he spoke to the believers, he preached the word. He was following what God asked him to do because he knew he shouldn't weary in doing good. Because at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. What a fantastic, fantastic message for us here today. There's a lesson about focus, isn't there? That verse that we read at the start, chapter 20, verse 24, "I consider my life worth nothing to me, if only I may finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me." One of the things that surprises me when I read the book of Acts is we're reading events that took place, as far as Paul's missionary journeys are concerned, of over 10 years. There isn't a lot on those pages for 10 years, is there? What about all the other stuff? Well, you know, I reckon there was actually quite a lot of mundane stuff. There was quite a lot of Paul sitting down and making a tent. There was quite a lot of Paul talking to his friends. It wasn't all miracles. It wasn't all preaching in the great auditoriums. But he persevered because he'd got focus. He knew he'd got a job to do. He knew he'd got a race to run. Paul knew that he'd got to complete the task that he'd been given. And there's a lesson for us about change. It's remarkable, isn't it, Paul's life. How would you feel if you were just on the road for over 10 years? You started off with a normal life. Your life is then turned upside down because you don't know what's coming next. You're facing all of those hardships. There was nothing that was the same from one day to the next. My life actually isn't like that. Monday morning this week, I suspect, might be quite similar to Monday morning last week. And it might be quite similar to the Monday before that and the Monday before that. And our lives sometimes lack change, and I wonder whether that's something more to do with me than actually listening to what God wants me to do. And I say that because I think there's a challenge there for us to look at the life of Paul and think, are we prepared to be on the move as Paul was on the move? Maybe not a physical on the move, but certainly spiritually. And finally, we read a lesson of trust, don't we? Paul knew that his life was simply in God's hand. And that's why when he was stoned, he got up and he walked back into the city. How many of us would have been stoned and thought, that's it. I've done my bit, Lord. I've got the scars to prove it now. I'm back off home. I've done my bit. No, he didn't, did he? Because he trusted completely. So I said about change, and we've just skimmed through looking at some of the highlights of the things that we've been looking at in this section of the book of Acts. And it's all about a journey, isn't it? And of course, the final big lesson for us is the one that reminds us that each of us is on a journey. And we are really actually on a journey like Paul. But I wonder whether the opportunities are before us to carry out the exploits like Paul did, but we're perhaps not quite tuned in to the Holy Spirit like Paul was. Perhaps we're staying too much in one place. Perhaps we're not accepting change like Paul did. Perhaps we need to fine-tune that focus, that idea that Paul had of running the race, not jogging along slowly and sitting down for a glass of orange juice, but running the race. Next time, we're going to look to see what happened to Paul's journey, because it's extraordinary, isn't it? As you've looked beyond that, if you've been starting to look beyond chapter 20, and you realize how prepared Paul was to continue with the commitment of the commission that he'd been given. So maybe this week, start looking beyond chapter 20. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you that you've given us your word. And we thank you for the stories that we can read about Paul, the events around his life, the extraordinary things that he did, the highs and the lows, the real terrible persecution, the threats to his life. But we thank you, Father, that throughout that, Lord, all the time that was going on, at the back of his mind, he knew that he was doing it because he was bringing the gospel to people who needed to hear it. He understood, Lord, how important it was that we love those around us, because that's the way you see people. And Father, the reason why we've been looking at Acts is because we want to be able to change like Paul did. What we want to do, Lord, is to be able to fulfill our mission in the way that he did. So, Father, can we ask you that as we're reading this book, as we reflect on Paul's life, as we read those extraordinary stories, Lord, in some way, would you help change our lives so that we can bring glory to you in the same way that Paul did? Because, Father, you know, we live in a pagan world like he did. We live in a world where people have really forgotten you, have moved away from you. And so, Father, we want to learn the lessons that Paul learned in his life. Because, Father, it's our desire that we would help your church grow here for your glory. Amen.
Okay, if we'd all like to stand and we'll say the grace to each other. Okay, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Guys, have a great day, and don't forget, 8 o'clock tonight, Carols with Compassion. God bless.